Mass for the fourth Sunday of Lent, Refreshment Sunday, Lentare Sunday, Mothery Sunday. And we have symbol cake to bless. I'll say something about that at the end of the liturgy. So let us now gather ourselves together here in this church, those who are watching, and prepare ourselves to celebrate these holy mysteries. Almighty God,
to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, confident in God's forgiveness. Merciful God,
our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to him in faith, pardon and set you free from all your sins, strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Surely the
Then Samuel said to Jesse, "Send him, send for him. We will not sit down to eat until he comes." Jesse had him sent for, a boy of fresh complexion, with fine eyes and pleasant bearing. The Lord said, "Come, anoint him, for this is the one."
be like children of light. For the effects of the light are seen in complete goodness, and right living, and truth. Try to discover what the Lord wants of you, having nothing to do with the futile works of darkness, but exposing them by contrast. The things which are done in secret are things that people are ashamed even to speak of. But anything exposed by the light will be illuminated, and anything illuminated turns into light. That is why it is said, "Wake up from your sleep, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
When the Pharisees asked him how he had come to see, he said, He put a paste on my eyes, and I washed, and I can see. Then some of the Pharisees said, this man cannot be from God. He does not keep the Sabbath. Others said, how could a sinner produce signs like this? And there was disagreement among them. So they spoke to the blind man again. What have you to say about him yourself, now that he has opened your eyes? He is a prophet, replied the man. However, the Jews would not believe that the man had been blind and had gained his sight without first sending for his parents and asking them, is this man really your son who you say was born blind? If so, how is it that he is now able to see? His parents answered, we know he is our son and we know he was born blind, but we don't know how it is that he can see now or who opened his eyes. He is old enough. Let him speak for himself. His parents spoke like this out of fear of the Jews, who had already agreed to expel from the synagogue anyone who should acknowledge Jesus as the Christ. This was why his parents said, he is old enough. Ask him. So the Jews again sent for the man and said to him, give glory to God. For our part, we know that this man is a sinner. The man answered, I don't know if he is a sinner. I only know that I was blind and now I can see. They said to him, what did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? He replied, I have told you once and you wouldn't listen. Why do you want to hear it all again? Do you want to become his disciples too? At this, they hurled abuse at him. You can be his disciple, they said. We are disciples of Moses. We know that God spoke to Moses. But as for this man, we don't know where he comes from. The man replied, now here is an astonishing thing. He has opened my eyes, and you don't know where he comes from? We know that God doesn't listen to sinners, but God does listen to men who are devout and do his will. Ever since the world began, it is unheard of for anyone to open the eyes of a man who was born blind. If this man were not from God, he couldn't do a thing. Are you trying to teach us? They reply. And you a sinner through and through since you were born? And they drove him away. Jesus heard they had driven him away, and when he found him, he said to him, do you believe in the Son of Man? Sir, the man replied, tell me who he is, so that I may believe in him. Jesus said, you are looking at him. He is speaking to you. The man said, Lord, I believe, and worshipped him. Jesus said, it is for judgment that I have come into this world, so that those without sight may see, and those with sight turn blind. Hearing this, some Pharisees who were present said to him, we are not blind, surely. Jesus replied, blind? If you were, you would not be guilty. But since you say, we see, your guilt remains. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Glory to you, Word of God. Lord,
long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. Which famous hymn about forgiveness and redemption has the line, "Was blind, but now I see"? Of course, it's Amazing Grace, one of the world's most popular hymns. Its words were written by English clergyman John Newton in the late 18th century. But Newton wasn't always a man of faith and compassion. Newton was a seafarer from an early age, and he was involved in the Atlantic slave trade. On one occasion, when his ship was caught up in a violent storm and seemed to be filling with water, he feared for his life and he called out to God for mercy. He survived, and the incident marked the beginning of his spiritual conversion. He went on to study theology and to speak and write about the evils of the slave trade, his own experience and sense of sin in having been part of it. That hymn, Amazing Grace, is written in the first person, reflecting Newton's feelings of wretchedness at his willful sin and distance from God, and then his experience of religious conversion, moving from blindness to sight, as well as being ordained. He became a hymn writer, and towards the end of his life, a prominent supporter of the abolition of slavery. The New Testament served as the basis for many of the lines and phrases of Amazing Grace. The first verse, for example, can be traced to the story of the prodigal son. In the Gospel of Luke, the father says, "For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and now is found." The story of Jesus healing the blind man, who tells Pharisees that he can now see, is today's reading from St. John's Gospel, a long passage. Imagine how excited the blind man must have been to see for the first time. He had a life-changing experience through this miracle. He would no longer need to beg to survive, and he readily shared his joy and acknowledged the healing power of Jesus. The way the story is told, the blind man progresses from darkness to light, not just physically, but in his understanding of what's going on. At first, he regards Jesus as a prophet. Finally, he believes in him as the Son of God, the Son of Man, the Messiah, the Christ. The Pharisees, on the other hand, first appear to accept the blind man's healing and then begin to doubt, and finally flatly deny Jesus' heavenly origins. They end up refusing to see, rendering themselves spiritually blind. The story of the blind man's physical healing takes exactly two scriptural verses. The controversy surrounding his cure, 39 verses. There is an analogy and a distinction between physical and spiritual blindness, as there are in most of the gospel miracle stories where Jesus heals blind people. The early Christians saw physical experience of the person of Jesus Christ. That is, regardless of such things as status, education, or well-being. And God's divine intervention can happen during the darkest moments of any of our lives. As the world faces the challenge of the COVID-19 epidemic, we need wisdom and insight to rise to the challenges we face together, to see how we can help and support one another, to see how we can bring the grace of God to each other, especially when faced with the sadness of not being able to be physically present to worship together, or perhaps not even physically present with our friends and loved ones. Today, as always, the Church invites us to reflect on God's love and compassion for the whole world, and to be joyful because of it. God loves each and every one of us, and today we are invited to say yes to God's love, to believe in the holiness of Jesus, and to recognize God's presence in the Eucharist, even when we cannot attend, and in our daily lives and struggles. By doing so, we will be able to say, "I was blind, but now I see." We are also called to have the humility to recognize that God works in others too, sometimes through the most unexpected people. How often do we refuse to believe that we can learn from those who oppose us and disagree with us? We make the effort to engage with people outside of our immediate family and friends? And what areas of the Church, society, and of our culture need serious healing in our own time? Where are the blind spots to addressing hardship and disability in our society? How is blindness to the common good being addressed? These questions will become sharper as we face the challenges ahead because of the pandemic. But perhaps answers will come with greater clarity. Where can we recognize the light of Christ shining in the world today? In our own community, in these dark times, we dare to celebrate God's love and healing power, as the blind man did after encountering Jesus. God's divine intervention helps us transform into people who live lives of goodness, generosity, and justice, always reflecting God's light. Together, let us affirm the faith of the Church. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the healed of his blindness, the man born blind proclaims, "Lord, I believe." With that faith in Christ, the light of the world, we come to the Father in prayer.
We pray that Christ, the light of the world, may shine through Christians everywhere, so that many people may be drawn into his kingdom. In particular, at this time of pandemic, we pray that Christians may show the love of Christ in all their actions and through their prayers by supporting all in need.
Lord, hear our prayer. Hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer. Hear our prayer.
May Christ, the light of the world, cast out selfishness, pride, and the worship of power from the minds of all people. Be with world leaders as they manage this crisis, and medical authorities as they strive to find a vaccine. Help people not to panic, but to be sensible in the way they protect themselves and the most vulnerable. In particular, we pray for health workers on the front line of care, aged care residents, workers and the families, teachers and all working with children, and those whose jobs and businesses are vulnerable.
Lord, hear our prayer, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer, hear our prayer.
On this Mothering Sunday, we pray for all mothers and for every parent and child. In particular, we pray for our parish family unable to come together in public worship at this time. Help us all to continue to keep in contact with one another, and especially to pray not only for ourselves, but for our whole world.
Lord, hear our prayer, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer. Hear our prayer.
We pray for the sick, especially those who have asked for our prayers, and all others on our hearts. Beth, Jackie Fitzgerald, Michael Adamo, Debbie Ashman, Helen Bennett, Janet Elford, Catherine Fremman, Bill Fremman, Mike Gibbons, Terry Reeves, Rosemary Holt, Helen Hoskins, Susan Kinney, Jean Knight, Margaret Moles, Miles McClendon, Mac Nashimeto, Cynthia Watts, and all struggling at this time.
Lord, hear our prayer, hear our prayer. our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord, by the mystery of the Incarnation, he has led the human race that walked in darkness into the radiance of the faith, and has brought those born in slavery to ancient sin through the waters of regeneration to make them your adopted children. Therefore, all creatures of heaven and earth sing a new song in adoration, and we, with all the host of angels, cry out, and without end we acclaim.
Jesus took bread, and when he had given you thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." For the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. The mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Therefore, Father, we do as our Saviour has commanded, proclaiming his offering of himself, made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection, and glorious ascension. And looking for his coming again, we celebrate with this bread and this cup his one perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Renew us by your Holy Spirit, unite us in the body of your Son, and bring us with Mary, the Virgin Mother of God, with Blessed John. those of her spouse, St. John, and all your people, into the joy of your eternal kingdom. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
With whom and in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father, in songs of never-ending praise.
Blessing and honor and glory and power are yours forever and ever. Amen.
At the Saviour's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
have mercy on us.
as it's Mothering Sunday, we're going to bless the single cake, which is hygienically wrapped. And if you want to receive a piece of single cake, please contact the office and we'll arrange to get you a piece of single cake. Let us pray. O God, in the loving embrace of your holy church, we are continually refreshed and nourished by word and sacrament, and strengthened by your Holy Spirit. Bless this single cake, and enable us to complete with greater fervour our Lenten observance. Bless all those who support and nourish others, and especially all mothers. May the prayers of Blessed Mary, Mother of all Christians, help us to persevere in our following of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, for ever and ever.
Amen.
We can't invite you to have a cup of tea or coffee with us, but hopefully you'll now have one and perhaps make contact with someone today. Bring up other members of the parish, make contact with them, and make sure that we are all looking after each other and keeping in touch at this time when we cannot worship together in our beautiful church. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Christ give you strength to overcome all temptation, to deny yourselves and to take up your cross and follow me. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you.